words make whole with all my soul. I thank you, I owe you all my devotion. It's all that I have to give. Here's my devotion. You're all that it means to live. All my past, my tainted name, you stole its legacy of pride and shame. You're all I love, you're all I fear. I'm drawing near to face you, to know you, to show you devotion. You're all time, in your perfect time. You found me in a shallow grave. You told me out from beneath it all. You touched me, saved me in the nick of time. In your perfect time, I devote all I have to you. I devote.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Flame of Faith United Methodist Church. I am so super excited to see everybody here. It's awesome. My name is Janson, if you don't already know. I'm a worship leader here, which should already be evident. And I'm also the administrative assistant, so I work in the office during the week. If you're interested in tonight's order of worship, you can go to our website, www.flameoffaithumc.org, and click on the button that says In-Person Worship. It'll take you to a page that has the whole order of the service. There's also a PDF file you can download that has all of the lyrics, the scripture, and the prayers, and other stuff on there. I put weird logos of Christian bands if we do a song by them. I didn't put a Newsboys logo, but I sure should have. Regret. We want to hear from you. Drop us an email or give us a call. Let us know that you're watching, those people at home. And if you have any ideas for how we can make this time a deeper, more powerful worship experience for everybody. All right, now I'd like to lead us into a time of prayer. We'll start with a time of silent prayer. I will continue with the pastoral prayer, and then we'll move into a slightly modernized version of the Lord's Prayer. The words will be on the screen, and they're in that PDF file, but please feel free to say it in whatever tradition you say it. And if you have any prayer requests, again, please let us know. We definitely want to hear from you. You can email us or call the office. All right, let us pray. gracious, loving, holy God. We come tonight to your house from different paths, from different houses, different backgrounds, different preferences, different focuses, different passions, different families, different stories. But when we come into your house, it's not those differences that define us. It's all that brings us together here. We're made one through Christ's flesh, through his ministry. The dividing walls between us have been broken down. The dividing lines we see today are only our creation. The truth is that there is only one Christ. May our lives show that unity in which Christ came to proclaim, the love which he gave his life for, the grace which sets all his people free. We pray for our neighbors in our own faith community and for our neighbors around the world in distress, in joy, and everything in between. We hear of pain and suffering. We also hear of joyous shouts. We hear concern and caring. There are also those voices that we will never hear, but are all well known to your ever-hearing presence. We hold all these things in our hearts as we pray to you. Make us your hands and feet that spread the news of the kingdom wherever we go. The kingdom that breaks down walls instead of creating them. We lift up all these prayers, said and unsaid, in the name of the one who takes down barriers to foster love, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray together as one people, saying, Our God in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Just as we come to God in prayer, so too we come to God giving of ourselves, our tithes, and our offerings. There are offering plates in the sanctuary when you come in and then when you leave. For people who are at home, you can give online, for anyone, I guess. You can give online through our website, www.flameoffaithumc.org/donate, or you can use the Give Plus app. Just search for Flame of Faith United Methodist Church. And you can also mail us a paper check if you're more comfortable with that. The address is on the screen. Please join me in praying over tonight's offering. Glorious God, please accept our humble gifts and bless them in creating miracles through the love of Christ. Amen.
Good evening again, everyone. It is a joy to worship alongside you. Thank you to Billy and Janson for beginning us with music tonight. What all our devotion to God. Couple of announcements before we get much further. You may have noticed a couple boxes of apples in the entryway. You can grab as many apples as you want. Those have come off of our apple tree. You can grab a couple off of the altar before they start to go bad up here, but make sure you grab them, eat them. They're wonderful if you enjoy apples. The New Life Center is having a fundraising dessert on October 13th. You can look on their website for more information about those tickets and everything. Daryl Strawberry will be there to share his story and how that connects to their ministry. So sounds like a pretty exciting night. Also, we are working on the details of our next adult Bible studies or book studies. If you are interested in participating, today's newsletter included a survey with, you can help us decide whether we're gonna study a book of the Bible, a book written on a specific topic, whatever we're going to do. And so if you are interested in that, go ahead and fill out that survey so that we know what to do next. Also, it is the time of year that we are starting to look and fill our leadership positions within the church. So if you are interested, if you're not a leader, a specific named leader in the church, and you want to participate in some way, let us know. And otherwise, you might be getting a phone call from one of us over the next few months asking you to lead in some way as we are looking to shift some positions around. Those are our announcements. Now I have three special young people I would like to bring up here. Would Harper, Ethan, and Emma come forward? All right. Come on. It is a joy to do this every year where we get to share our love of God and our love of God's stories with our young people. And so these three, as well as Grace Renwick, who received her Bible on Monday night, are receiving their first full Bibles. So these are some pretty cool Bibles. They're a lot like the ones that you've been using in Sunday school, but they have a whole lot more words in them. And they have all the stories. So parents, I like to remind you that they have all the stories. The good ones, the hard ones, and the ones you really don't want to have to answer questions about, but you will have to answer questions about because they will read them. And that is the fun of learning and growing in our faith. And so I invite everyone to participate in a liturgy with me, and so you're going to have a part. Can you see on the back wall where I have my screen? So it says pastor, so that's my line. In a minute, it's going to say congregation, and then it's going to say you all have to say something, okay? All right. So to you three and to Grace, who has already received hers, receive the word of God, learn its stories, and study its words. Its stories belong to us all, and these words speak to us all. They tell us who we are. They tell us that we belong to one another and that we are people of God. So this is your line. Can you read it together? We receive. Do you need me to join in? We receive these Bibles with our hands, our hearts, and our minds. Thank you. We will read and study the Bible together. We've got the three shyest third graders. All right, congregation, can you speak a little louder than these three? This is another one that's all of us. The word of God is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Thanks be to God. All right. Well, can you three stand over there so that your parents can get the pictures they want one at a time? Can you stand over here? And then I'll call you over to get your Bible. And Harper, you're actually first. So, I know. Harper Kelly, here is your Bible. And we're going to look and smile at your mom. Can you smile at your mom? All right. Emma. Oh, no. You both have E's. Ethan. Come on over. Ethan Kemmerling, here is your Bible. And there's your dad and your mom. They've got two angles. All right, go back over to Harper. And there's Emma. All right. There's your mom. All right, can you all lift up your hands and bless these three with me? God, I ask you to bless these three young people and Grace at home. Bless them for their lives, that they may read your stories and hear the words of your people that they may know your love in all that they do. In your precious and holy name, amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. And here is a picture of Grace receiving her Bible on Monday night so that she could participate as well. Our third graders are going to be getting, really get out of the way for the camera. Sorry to you at home, I forgot to pay attention to that. So we will be having a retreat here in the next few weeks helping the third graders to understand the different parts of the Bible, the different details of what's going on. For those of you who have older siblings or cousins that might be able to help you out, they have similar Bibles. And actually saw the picture of when Jack got his Bible, and he was just as small as Emma. They might be able to help you out with some of those details. I know your cousins would probably help you out. And parents and grandparents are always a good person to ask for questions. But we'll have some time to do that later in the month. Many of you know also we have started our confirmation program this year. And so we've got confirmation kids in 7th, 8th, and 9th grade. 10th grade, sorry. They are starting to dig into their faith and their history and those kind of things. So if you know of any of the kids that are in those, reach out to them, share your faith with them, tell them your stories. And if you're a part of their family, they might ask you, one of their responsibilities this year is to interview a family member about your faith. So some of you might get a phone call from one of your students. Okay, so we have been talking about promises. Over the last few weeks, we've been talking about the promises of God, from creation and the promise of life, to Abraham and the promise of progeny, to Joseph and the promise of safety from famine. The problem with our stories, though, they include the addition of humanity. Wouldn't it be easier sometimes if a whole story was just God and it was all perfect and we weren't involved in them so much? But just as Joseph and his family become safe from starvation, it doesn't take long for the evils of humanity to take over. And so the Israelites become enslaved by the Egyptians. But even under the burden of slavery, the Israelites continue to grow in size, continuing to be fruitful and multiply as God asked them to. And so Pharaoh, he gets jealous, and Pharaoh declares that all the firstborn male children would be killed. But the midwives, they secretly keep them alive. This is a really cool story. For those of you who just got those Bibles, you can read the whole story if you want. The midwives, they lie to Pharaoh about what's happening, and they save the lives of all these children in a pattern of secret resistance. And so in this way, Moses is born and saved. He is literally sent down the river in a basket to be saved again by Pharaoh's own daughter. And he becomes a child raised in Pharaoh's house with his own mother, his birth mother, as his nursemaid, and he is raised to rule not as a slave. Eventually, Moses' story gets a little complicated. After murdering a guard who had beaten a slave, Moses runs into the wilderness, where a new family raises and teaches him. So Moses, who is a child of Abraham, a grandchild of Abraham, is raised by three separate families throughout the story. And three separate cultures, interestingly enough. He has an Israelite birth mother, he has an adopted Egyptian mother, and then the Midianite family he marries into in the desert. And if you were paying close attention to last week's story, the Midianites are the descendants of Ishmael, and so they are also family. In the wilderness, Moses encounters the presence of God calling him out of the burning bush. Moses challenges Pharaoh, comes back into the city, challenges Pharaoh, and the plagues are sent by God. And in the meantime, God, through Moses, helps the Israelites escape. And in this moment, so that's all the story that happens between last week and this week. This is the moment that we hear of the time of Passover. And so this comes from Exodus chapter 12, 1 through 13. Now, if you just got a Bible, Exodus is the second chapter in the book, and you can find that. And if you look, there are big numbers, and that's your chapter number, 12. And then the little itty-bitty numbers on the sides, those are the verse numbers. So chapter 12, verses 1 through 13, I can see you've all got family helping you out. Good job, family. So here is the scripture today. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year-old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. And they'll take the blood and put it on two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast over the fire with head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, your staff in hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. And on the gods of Egypt I will execute my judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." Now, to those of you who are looking in your Bibles, we're switching to the next chapter, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. The Lord said to Moses, "Consecrate to me all the firstborn, whatever it is, the first to open the womb among the Israelites of human beings and animals is mine." Moses said to the people, "Remember this day on which you came out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, because the Lord brought you from there by strength of hand. No leavened bread shall be eaten. Today, in the month of Abib, you are going out. When the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites, which he swore to your ancestors to give you, a land flowing with milk and honey, you shall keep this observance in this month. For 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread, and on the seventh day there shall be a festival to the Lord. Unleavened bread shall be eaten for 7 days. No leavened bread shall be seen in your possession, and no leaven shall be seen among you in all your territory. You shall tell your children on that day, 'It is because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt.'" Here ends our reading for the night. So the practice of Passover, we're not quite to this joke yet. The practice of Passover is essential in Jewish tradition. Passover is the telling of the story in our scripture today. God instructs the Israelites to celebrate year after year. And so an important question in our scripture becomes, why would God care if the Israelites celebrated and remembered? This is central to the questions of foundation and community. And the telling of the story which reminds us and reminds the people of Israel, and thus the people of Christ, that it is in the storytelling we remember both our aspect as people who were slaves, and out of that history, out of that story, is deliverance from that bondage. The questions of Passover become the central story of who Israel is. You can ask, why do we have a day of rest? Because in the land of Egypt, when you were slaves, even then you were able to rest. They were asked, why do we care for the stranger in our land? Because once we were strangers in the land of Egypt. Who is God? God is the one who saved us from the land of Egypt. God asks the Israelites to remember, and not just the parts of the story which they were successful, but also the struggles and the pain others went through for their freedom. It's an interesting story that sometimes we all struggle with when we pretend that history and our stories, they only include the happy-go-lucky movements. We find, or moments, not movements, we find ourselves forgetting the horribleness of what we can be as humanity. And then when the stories of history are told and only the stories are good ones, we lose the difficulty, we lose the honestness. If, as we spoke about last week, if every single one of us contains both sin and righteousness, then the stories of our history also hold those moments. When you look at U.S. history, our history, you can't tell the history of Western expansion of our time here in North Dakota without the genocide of the original tribes. I've heard the Civil War explained as a simple states versus states' rights versus federalism conversation without any mention of slavery. So when we look at the story of Passover and the story of Exodus, it could be easily told in one way. If the Israelites stood up and said, you know, the Egyptians were all terrible, wholly evil, and they deserved all the terrible plagues, every single bit. And the story kind of begins that way. Because slavery is evil and horrible, and genocide is evil and horrible, and yet it is more than that. And here's where my joke comes in. So if you know the Night at the Museum movies, Ben Stiller, the concept of the movies is that the statues inside the museums become alive. So these are the statues of ancient pharaoh and queen. They ask who his people are. He says he's half Irish, half Jewish. The ancient king, presumably the pharaoh in our story, says, "You are? I love the Jews. We owned 40,000 of them. They were always happy with the singing and the candles." And Ben Stiller's character, he says they weren't really happy. They left, spent about 40 years in the desert trying to escape. We have a dinner once a year to complain about it. It's a pretty funny moment. And also reminds us to tell the right story, the whole story. Because the glorious beauty of Passover is realization that the whole story hurt people. In the telling of the Passover story in the Haggadah, which is the script used in that telling, it includes an acknowledgement that the plagues were awful. The story of Passover includes grieving the Egyptian lives lost. I want you to think about that. Our culture isn't very good at that. We don't know how to grieve for lives lost we don't think have much worth. We don't know how to live with compassion when someone disagrees with our politics, let alone with someone who might have hurt us. Our country, our society, we've lost the ability to live in compassion and righteousness. And I know it's hard. It's hard to say, I'm horrified and I grieve and I wonder what can I do? What can I say? How can I do good in this mist? And then I pout a little bit and I ignore it. But this is hard work. It's easier to wallow in my anger and ignore everyone who is different than me and assume the worst of it all. But God asked the Israelites to remember the whole story. God tells the Israelites to remember, to gather, and to care for one another in the remembering. It's about community and connection. In the ritual, they grieve for the lives lost in the Egyptians. In remembering, we can look forward with the insight to see a different future. In the story of Exodus, we learn that God is on the side of the oppressed. In the story of Exodus, we learn that the people will always cry out for help, and that God is always listening. And when we Christians take our turn at remembering this Sunday and next Wednesday, we're going to tell the story of the Last Supper. The story of Christ and the disciples at the Last Supper as they celebrated Passover. We remember the story of death and resurrection and the communal table of God that gathers us together. In the story of Exodus, we're reminded that change is rarely done without upheaval. And the story of the Last Supper reminds us just the same. Humanity rarely embraces change without a fight. For the Israelites, the most important part of who God is for them. God is the God who brought them out of Egypt. God is the God who works toward the good of creation. God is actively working against the work of evil and greed in our world. That's the story that's continually retold throughout the Old Testament. That even in the worst of things, God was with them. God listened. God calls them to live lives that remember that story. Tonight, we have given gifts of faith and memory to our third graders. In the story of our faith, in the book of our scriptures, we find ourselves telling the whole hard story. From the difficulties of the plagues in Egypt to the fighting in the desert, there's stories we'd rather not read, and most of us haven't. There's stories of incredible joy and wonder of God. There's even stories about sex. Sorry, parents. There are the prophets who call us to the carpet to remind us of what God demands. There's the, and grandparents, goodness, getting glared at. There's the life of Christ that opens us to the life that is focused outward. There's the hope of resurrection and the wonder of Easter. There's the difficulties the early church struggled with trying to live together as a community. These are all in that book, that precious book that we read and look through. These young people are receiving their first, what I call, adult Bible. And we are called to read and to speak and to tell God's story alongside them. And it starts here. It starts in our connections and our readings, and it continues when we tell our connections to God. So you parents and family that are part of this, part of the story of God is the stories that you tell. Remember that God was with you in the worst times of your life. Remember that God has called us out of slavery of sin and slavery to death and slavery to so much in our lives. Remember that we are all called to new life. And each and every person, as we hear those stories, as we hear of our faith and we share, we are telling God's story anew. I invite you all to share that story with each other and with others, this day and always. Let us pray. God of us all, thank you for your stories. Thank you for your gift of faith and the gifts of your promises. Help us to hear and to see and to share them this day. Amen. I now invite Janson and Billy forward for our final song.
Children free. El
Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Yon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Ekum Kon. Time of Christ was near, though the people couldn't see what Messiah ought to be. Though your word contained the plan, they just would not understand. Your most awesome work was done through the frailty of your Son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Yon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same. By the power of your name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Ekum Kon Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Stand and hear the benediction tonight. Let us believe God's promises. Let us trust in the Lord and truly live filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen.